May the words I say and the things I do make my life song sing, bring a smile. Good Sunday evening to you all. I hope and pray that you find this message as a blessing to you and that it will help you. I am Associate Pastor Joe Wood of Pleasant Hill Baptist Church. And I want to tell you tonight, this will be the last message in chapter 2. And for the most part, we have been looking in chapter 2 about comparing Jesus Christ to other things. Well, tonight we want to talk about the truths about cults. The truths about cults. Now, as we know here, they were, speaking of Paul here, they were being forced into ideas. The Colossians were being forced into ideas about the world, false philosophies and rituals that were not of God, nor what the Lord Jesus Christ commanded them to do. And they were persuaded by the things of the world that allowed them to think they were doing right when they were doing wrong. So as you would, please go with me to Colossians chapter 2, and we're going to read verses 16 through 23. Colossians chapter 2, verses 16 through 23. It says, "Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink, or in respect of an holiday, or of the new moon, or of the Sabbath days, which are of a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ. Let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he had not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind, and not holding the head, from which all the body, by joints and bands, having nourishment, ministered and knit together, increaseth with the increase of God. Wherefore, if ye be dead with Christ from the rudiments in the world, why as though living in the world are you subjects to ordinances? Touch not, taste not, handle not, which all are to perish with the using, out of the commandments and the doctrines of man, which things have indeed a show of wisdom and will worship, and humility and neglecting of the body, not in an honor to the satisfying of the flesh." So I want us to see tonight the truths about cults. As John Phillips writes, he says, "From the beginning, the church has had to contend with those who would shackle it with Jewish ideas up the Jewish religion. If it wasn't someone wanting to impose circumcision, it was someone wanting to force the Sabbath on the church." He talks about that in chapter 2. The law had become an intolerable burden to the Jews, a fact that comprised mostly of Gentiles. Furthermore, he went on to say, "As a way of introduction, much confusion has arisen in the church from the failure to distinguish between the Mosaic law as a standard and the Mosaic law as a system." End of quote. As a standard, you and I know the law proclaims binding and deathless rules of conduct. Although even at that, all can be summed up in the commandment to love one another's neighbor as oneself. Now, as a system, the law represents and upholds a vast system of God-ordained religion distorted by the rabbis and their traditions. This system, which we meet constantly in the four Gospels and the book of Acts, was abolished at Calvary. So then on the day of Pentecost, Judaism itself was replaced by the church. My dear brethren, the one thing that I pray that you see through this message is that you and I are no longer under the laws of the Old Testament. Do we follow the laws that man have placed before us? No. You and I are blood washed, born again, child of Almighty God. Don't you forget that. And don't allow someone or something to change your idea of what Jesus Christ has done in your life. Rules and regulations are essential. However, one will always break them in some form or fashion. However, that is when the love of Christ comes in and forgives the believer. So as we look at this passage, I want us to think about two things tonight. The first one I want us to see is the warning against cultic behavior. The warning against cultic behavior in verses 16 through 19. In verses 16 through 17, we see cultic behavior has seeped into the church. As I want to read it one more time. Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holiday or of the new moon or of the Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ. Rules and rituals were the problem that Paul was dealing with. As one wrote, some believers were reverting back to rules and rituals and judging others by them. Some false teachers were diverting the attention of some believers away from Christ. They were saying that rules and rituals were to be the focus of man's attention and life. Also, that man became acceptable to God by keeping certain rules and rituals. Finally, that man pleased God by eating and drinking the right foods and by keeping certain religious rituals and holidays. And holy days, excuse me. End of quote. This led, my dear brethren, to some of the believers focusing more on rituals and than Christ. They had forgot the very reason that Jesus Christ had came. He took the rituals, he took the rules, and placed them on the cross of Calvary so that you and I could be set free from these things. However, in a cultic manner, some had believing that you had to continue going about doing the same things that you once did. They were legalistic in their approach with the Lord. Is legalistic ideas still a problem today? Absolutely they are. There is many individuals that take things from the Bible and make them into their own ideas. People think you can't wear this or you can't wear that, and you have to do this, and you can only listen to this type of Christian music, and the rest is of the world, and there is only one Bible, and the rest of the translations are filthy. And even though they come from the same manuscripts, but people are still believing. Now, I am a King James Version Bible preacher, and I preach from the King James, but I do, if I'm honest with you, I do read from other translations such as the ESV and the New King James and the New American. And I like to read those. They're easier to comprehend. But there are many people that think that there is only one Bible. And there are many people that think that that you have to dress a certain way. And yes, I do believe that you should dress modestly. And you should dress in the best clothing that you have. But God does not define modest as a certain outfit. He just talks about covering oneself. And so as we think about that, the same goes for the Colossian church. Some believe they had to still go by the rules and rituals, but Jesus Christ didn't say they did. So we have seen here, first, cultic behavior had seeped into the church. Secondly, I want you to see cultic behavior was displayed through spiritism in verses 18 through 19. He says, let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he hath not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind, and not holding the head from which all the body by joints and bands, having nourishment ministered and knit together, increaseth which the increase of God. So one must ask, what am I talking about here when I'm talking about spiritism? Spiritism is the worship of God through angels or spirits and visions. The problem in the church at Colossae were many were placing all their thoughts on things that are not reliable, nor what the Lord had commanded you and I to see. It wasn't their power in anything, nor who they were, but the power of Christ. And that's what Paul was trying to get across here. William Barclay writes, "No one will deny the visions of the mystics, but there is always a danger when a man begins to think that he has attained a height of holiness which enables him to see what common men, as he calls them, cannot see. And the danger is that men will so often see not what God sends them, but what they want to see." Now, I want you to hear that, what they want to see. You and I realize that this is still common in our society today. Many like to interpret things that may not be correct, but are how they desire. People will say, "I believe this is the way that God is leading me," but in reality, they are just saying, "This is what I want to happen, but I'm going to use the God card to make it happen." Have you ever heard anyone doing that? Certainly. We all have, and if we're honest with ourselves, we may be guilty of it as well. I remember my father always telling me, "Son, at times there is a major difference between what you want and what God wants," and how true this is. And this is where some of the Colossians were. They desired one thing and was professing they had received a word from the Lord. So we have seen here first the warning against cultic behavior. I want you to see secondly the results of cultic behavior in verses 20 through 23. The first thing we see in verse 20 is one becomes subject to ordinances of the world. He says, "Wherefore, if you be dead with Christ from the rudiments of the world, why, as though living in the world, are you subject to ordinances?" Rudiments meant here crude notions of men about the universe, that is, about God, reality, and truth. It is man's idea and philosophies, their elementary or rudimentary teachings. There are many false teachers in our society today that push many ways to God. However, I would like to share with you a couple of thoughts that we need to consider. First, as we think about how there are many ways to God, we must first understand that there isn't, and there are two reasons why. First, no matter what law that we are not able to keep perfectly. No matter what the law is, we are not able to keep perfectly. As you and I know, we are sinners. We are guilty of failing in our lives. The guiltiness of our failure causes one to realize their need of Jesus Christ. However, when one realizes that we are not perfect, we can then see our sin for what it truly is. If we sin once, then we have fallen short of the glory of God. No matter what one may say, that is truth of God's word, and that is what you and I need to stand for, is only the truths of God's word, no matter what one says. Secondly, we stand guilty before God because of our sin. One that stands guilty in front of a jury is sentenced to punishment. I don't care what someone may say to you, you are guilty before God because of your sin. Your sin separates you from His love, and because of that, you and I need to realize our sin causes us to be sentenced to eternal death, but without the mercy and grace of Jesus Christ. But because of His mercy, because of His grace, you and I have been free from our sin because of Jesus Christ. Secondly, I want you to see not only does one become subject to the ordinance of the world, but secondly, one becomes enslaved to men's rules and teachings. It says in verse 21 and 22, "Touch not, taste not, handle not, which are all to perish with the using after the commandments and doctrines of men." When one places their faith and trust in men or the thoughts of men, then they have lost their way. No time in history of this world has God ever been wrong or His word been incorrect truth. The thoughts of man are not based upon absolute truth. You and I can have an opinion or a thought upon what the word of God teaches us. However, though, I want you to see this. As Preacher's Outline Sermon Bible states, the point is this: the philosophies and ideas of men enslave us. They force us to commit our lives to them and to focus upon them, and then they leave us enslaved to the bondage of death. Man-made ideas do not free us. They can carry us. No higher than the man who made up the idea, and that height is not height at all. It is a depth of death to which all men go. So going back to my previous statement, I said you and I can have an opinion or a thought upon what the Word of God teaches us. However, though, that thought, that idea, if it is different than the Word of God, it will only take you as far as you can go, and that is nowhere without Jesus Christ. So as we think about as people are teaching incorrect truth, and if you and I start believing that, then we become enslaved to men's rulings and teachings. And then the final thing in verse 23 that I want you to see is, as one, the reality of the results of cultic behavior, one becomes subject to ordinance of the world that leads to enslaved to man's ideas and teachings. And then finally, what happens there next? One becomes engulfed with man instead of God. And that is the truth of cultic behavior. That is the result of cultic behavior. One becomes engulfed with man instead of God. Verse 23. Which things have indeed a show of wisdom in will worship and humility and neglecting of the body, not in any honor to the satisfying of the flesh. So one, when one is enslaved to a man's idea of what is right, as they believe in them more than God, then they become engulfed in man instead of God. I want to ask a question. Where are our desires supposed to be? They are to be in God and God alone. We are to look to God and His Word for all direction. So in closing, the question that we must ask is this. Where are we looking for guidance today? Do we believe what we believe because someone has told us that, or it's because it is based upon the Word of God? When I was teaching at North Wilkes, I used to tell my kids that no matter what you believe, believe it because you have done the homework. You know about it. And don't just believe it because someone else has told you. Let me tell you, my dear brethren, beware lest you fall from the truths of God's Word. There are cults everywhere. And the reality is this, if you and I do not defend, do not know why we believe what we believe, and that is the Word of God, then we may fall. So I encourage you to beware lest you fall from the truths of God's Word. May God bless you, and I pray that this message tonight has been a blessing and encouragement to you, but also a challenge to you. And Lord willing, next Sunday night, we will be back in-house at Pleasant Hill, October 3rd, and we will begin chapter 3 of our study in the book of Colossians.